Anita Morgan says, what can be done to reverse hypothyroidism other than taking thyroid medicine? I've been taking desiccated thyroid, nature thyroid, and one drop of Lugol's iodine per day. My doctor's data hair test shows iodine of 1.0. However, a drop of iodine on my skin takes a long time to absorb. I'll throw in a couple things. So if you just look at the nutrients needed to make thyroid hormone, you're looking at enough protein in addition to enough iodine. But then also the production of thyroid hormone is a very, very dirty process that requires an enormous amount of antioxidant support. And so selenium is very important. But also, you know, if you're looking at antioxidant protection, you're looking at not just things that we think of as dietary antioxidants, but you're looking at protein, zinc, iron, copper, manganese, in addition to selenium. You're looking at vitamin C, vitamin E, and a whole bunch, sort of a Pandora's box that you're opening up. So I think that probably the things that stand out the most are protein, iodine, and selenium, but really you have a pretty big network of supportive nutrients in the background. Of course, everything I just said assumes that you're missing something that you need to make thyroid hormone, which is not necessarily the case, but I covered part of it. Do you want to take it from there?
That was going to just say that on top of that, making sure you understand the difference between, do you have cellular or peripheral hypothyroidism? So many things can get in the way of converting your T4 into your T3, high estrogen, high leptin, high insulin, high cortisol, low progesterone, low DHEA. And so if you have any of these things, you may be deemed hypothyroid, but really it's these peripheral factors play into it as well.
Okay. Thank you, Anita. Let's see. Anonymous says a lot of things. Let's see. Do you have any experience with iodine restriction for treating Hashimoto's? Carrie, do you have any thoughts on that?
I don't. No, not with iodine restriction for Hashimoto's. How about you?
I don't have experience with it, but I'll say that I read about this in Datis Karazian's book, Why Do I Still Have Thyroid Symptoms When All My Lab Tests Are Normal? And I looked at the studies that he cites, and I didn't think they were very convincing. So there is an argument out there that basically the argument is that the Hashimoto's is driven by oxidative stress and driving inflammation that is a result of not being able to protect the thyroid under the conditions that make thyroid hormone. And so if you put more iodine in there, you're going to increase thyroid hormone production. You're going to increase all of the damaging things that you're not, that you don't have adequate protection against. And there was back in the day, quite a while ago, there was a very extensive back and forth debate on the Perfect Health Diet website between a few people on this. And I agree with the conclusions that they came to, which is that you, under those conditions, you definitely want to make sure that you're not missing key things that are needed to protect the thyroid. But as long as you're adequate in those, and, you know, chief among them would be selenium. But I have to add here that I really don't think anyone should supplement with more than 100 micrograms of selenium if they're not measuring their plasma selenium, because you basically have a 50-50 chance of having too much or too little selenium because the soil distribution is completely random. And plants do not regulate how much selenium they take up, which is different in principle than every other mineral. Like, for example, if you have a place where the soil has toxic levels of copper in it, it's going to increase on average the food copper accumulation by 25% because the plants control their copper intake or uptake homeostatically, whereas selenium, they don't. And if you have three times the level of selenium in the soil, you're going to have three times the level of selenium in the plants. And so I don't think it's wise for people to just throw 200 micrograms a day of selenium in because they have Hashimoto's. But I do think it makes sense to say, before I'm going to supplement with iodine, I'm going to make sure that I have selenium and the other things in place that I need to protect my thyroid gland during the process of making thyroid hormone. And so, but I think that's the limit to iodine restriction. I don't think it makes sense to treat Hashimoto's by just completely avoiding iodine, because at some point down the line, you're not going to have any thyroid hormone if you don't have any iodine. So that's my thought on that. Okay. Brent, no. What are the implications for hormonal balance of following a low carb or ketogenic diet? Are there concerns to watch for? I'll throw a couple things out. So first of all, if you don't have enough carbohydrate to feed your body's demand for it. So even on a ketogenic diet, your brain's consumption of glucose goes down 75%, but your brain consumes 120 grams of glucose a day when you're not on the ketogenic diet. And so your total demand for glucose is at maximum going down. And what I mean, the maximum decrease in your need for carbohydrate would be that it could go down to maybe 45 grams a day if you're very keto adapted. And that is, that's referring to the amount of carbohydrate you need to burn for energy. So you can make that carbohydrate through gluconeogenesis, but one of the key regulators of gluconeogenesis is cortisol. And if cortisol doesn't normalize your blood glucose levels, you can also get adrenaline pumping in. So you can throw things off that way. The other thing is that you won't find this in any textbook on hormones, but insulin acts on the thyroid gland to mimic about half of what TSH does on the molecular level. And so insulin is like, if you look at like how much TSH do you need to make the amount of thyroid hormone that you need, it's contextual among your, against your insulin level, because if you take out the insulin, then you basically need more TSH to make the same amount of thyroid hormone. And if you're not ramping up the TSH, you will probably have a decline in thyroid hormone. And in fact, if you look at T3 levels on low carbohydrate diets, they tend to go down. And some low carbohydrate diet advocates will actually, like, there are some people that think low T3 is good for your lifespan. I think Ron Rosedale was making this argument that you want to be on a low carbohydrate diet so that you will lower your T3 so that you will live longer. So there's that. And then also elevated free fatty acids that's one of the factors. And you were talking about peripheral thyroid hormone metabolism. So one of the factors that determines the actual transport of thyroid hormone into the cell and binding to the nuclear receptor to affect gene expression is the free fatty acid level. So I think declines in, and thyroid hormone regulates sex hormone production and other things. So I think that you have the potential for a decrease in thyroid hormone and sex hormones and an increase in cortisol. And I'm not saying that happens in everyone, but it's just one of the things that could happen. And I originally was very interested in this because I was talking to someone who was a type 1 diabetic, and they were managing their type 1 diabetes by basically eating zero carb, but their testosterone and thyroid hormone levels were low. And their question was, clearly there's a cause and effect relationship there, but is it better to eat carbohydrate and take insulin, or is it better to live with low testosterone levels? And so those are my thoughts. Do you have anything you want to add to that?
Well, the one thing that I would add is, because I work for a hormone lab and see thousands and thousands and thousands of them, the number of people that are on a keto type diet and their hormones are a mess, is often, I have a lot of doctors, a lot of practitioners who are trying keto, or, you know, something like that. And, they call me and they're like, I feel terrible. I feel like everything's a mess. We run their hormone tests, and sure enough, it is. And oftentimes they're like, forget it. I'm not doing this anymore. I'm gonna quit this. And they'll go and get a blood work done for their thyroid. Their thyroid's also a mess. And and again, just like you said, this isn't everybody for sure. Definitely some very fat adapted people are doing great, have no issue. But the number of complaining or irritated or hormonally imbalanced practitioners that I talk to who have tried, who have been doing keto is outweighs the ones that are doing it and testing and feel really good. However, keep in mind the patient population I'm seeing are, they're calling me because something's wrong. If something's not wrong, they're not going to call me.
They have hormone problems.
Yeah.
By default. Yeah.